Your bulletin says, now is the time for a hymn and the gospel. But that's not true. I decided to do something different tonight. And so you can tell me after the service how it strikes you. And that is to preach the sermon before you hear the gospel. Why would I do this? The three sermons that are really on offer tonight, my friends, are not what this person will be saying. The first of the sermons on offer is the action that you'll see in a moment when we follow the commandment of Jesus to do this as he has done by washing one another's feet. That's a sermon in action. The second sermon in this beautiful liturgy will be what happens as we break the bread and raise up the cup and repeat the words that the Lord spoke over bread and wine at the Last Supper when he gathered with his beloved right before he was handed over to be crucified. The third sermon that you will hear and see tonight is the stripping of the sanctuary. The stripping of the altar decorations, the removal of everything that adorns this part of our worship space will be removed, leaving only bareness, emptiness, because tonight, after the Last Supper, Jesus was handed over following his agonizing night in the Garden of Gethsemane. It's only hours until Jesus is tried, brutally crucified, and laid in the tomb. And so what I'm proposing to do here in this different place is a little bit what the symphony notes in the symphony program do if you get there early, before the music starts, and you get a chance to read and think forward as something in that notes calls your attention to something you're about to hear. That's my hope as we begin this journey of 3 days of Triduum, is for me to simply call your attention to the wondrous things that are in the gospel you're about to hear. Call me symphony notes. First of all, we know what was on the heart of Jesus as this story took place. He knew that his time had come, we are told, as the text begins. Jesus knew that his time had come to depart from this world and to return to the Father. He knew that. That was deep in his consciousness, doubtless not nearly so well understood by those he was having supper with. But he knew it. He knew it was his time. And then it says, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. So you'll hear at the very outset of this gospel that Jesus knew his death was coming and his heart was rich with love for his own, that he would indeed love until his very last breath. Then there's that little interruption that points our attention away from Jesus to Judas, who was present at supper with everyone, on the same basis as all of the other 11. But we do get a parenthetical backstage note that Satan had already put it into Judas's heart to betray Jesus. Then the narrative comes back to where Jesus is and what's going on within him, and there is that wonderful sentence, having then given over everything to his Father, knowing that he had come from God and was returning to God, then Jesus at supper began to wash feet. Knowing that he had come from God and was returning to God. Hold that thought. I want to tell you about my friend, Jay. Years ago, when I was a hospice chaplain working in an AIDS hospice in Chicago, Jay was one of my very first and closest patients. This was in the early 1980s. We didn't even have the word AIDS yet. We called it HTLV, and people were trying to struggle with what to call this particular syndrome. It was long before antiretrovirals were there to make it possible for someone to live with the HIV virus. Jay was dying fast. Now, Jay had been an Episcopalian. He had been raised, he'd sung in choirs, he'd been an acolyte. But during the course of his adult life, as he came to terms with who he was and how he was to live his life, as a gay man, the church treated him brutally. My church, our church, yes. And for his own sanity and wholeness, he built a strong and thick layer of protection against anything the church would offer him. And I understood completely. He was simply protecting himself from what he understood to be awful prejudice. As a result, he stopped believing. And here he is in his last weeks with no faith to cling to. But God doesn't give up on any of us. And as I sat with him day by day, listening, loving, reassuring, offering what comfort I could see God literally crack Jay open until he began asking different kinds of questions, until he began sounding like the shred of belief was taking root inside his heart and soul. So as he got sicker and sicker, and we knew time was running out, I was required to be away because I had a sabbatical plan to go to Russia. I saw Jay for the last time when he was literally days from death. And we both cried, and we both said the five things you need to say in your lifetime. I love you, I forgive you, thank you, forgive me, God bless you. We said all of those five important things to each other. As we were leaving, he held my hand and he said, I'll see you later. And I didn't understand. So I said, well, Jay, I think this is goodbye and I won't be back for several weeks. And the most beautiful smile and the most radiant look on his ravaged face said, Chilton, I'll see you later. That's the kind of confidence Jesus had as he began this meal with his beloved. And so he takes a towel and washes their feet. He washes everyone's feet. There's no one left out, which means that he washed Judas, the betrayer. He also washed Peter, who in a matter of hours would deny ever knowing him. He washed every single pair of feet around that table. He did what the lowest of the slaves did in an average household of that day. Roads were dirt, animals, people, traffic. By the time someone had walked to your house for dinner, their feet desperately needed to be washed. And then he comes to Peter, and as Jesus prepares to wash Peter, Peter protests. Here is where I think the love message needs to come home pointedly. It's so hard to let someone love us. It's so hard to let God love us to the extent God does. We can't even comprehend the dimensions of God's love, the immensity of it. But we certainly are embarrassed by our dirty feet. And it is here tonight that love invites us to literally put one foot out and take a step into receiving love and care in the name of Jesus. He told us to. He told us to. Near the end of that passage that you will hear in just a moment, after he's washed their feet, he gets himself back to his robe and into his seat at the table, and he begins a theology lesson. Very Anglican of him. Action, reflection. First do the thing, and then reflect on what it means. Then as he's reflecting with them about what has just happened, he talks about how this, your Lord and teacher, has showed you you are to do for one another. Not only the actual washing of the feet, but everything that partakes of that kind of humility, that is willing to be that vulnerable, not only to take that slave's position, but to do what Peter eventually did, and that is to receive this loving and merciful care from Jesus. This night is all about love. It's about having loved his own who were in the world and loving them to the end. That's how it starts. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, he began to wash their feet. And so let this be my invitation to you, to let your feet be washed tonight. If for some reason of disability or difficulty, you would prefer to participate in washing, there is a hand washing station at the back, and you can participate in that way. But allow yourself to take one deeper step into receiving this immense and mysterious love, which is what this Triduum is about. And now, let's hear the symphony.